Very warm good afternoon to everyone and welcome to plenary session 2 of GHTC 2020. We are privileged to have with us two of the most well-known international speakers for this session, Professor Dimitrios Bouhalis and Professor Lorenzo Cantoni. Before proceeding with the session, I would like to give a brief introduction of our first speaker, that is Professor Dimitrios Bouhalis. He is the director of e-tourism lab in Bournemouth University, Poole, Dorset, UK. He specializes in strategic management and marketing with the use of disruptive technologies. His research is referenced widely, being the third most cited for tourism and first most cited for hospitality, 18th on strategy and 30th in marketing on Google Scholar, with more than 43,000 citations and H index 87. He has written and co-edited more than 20 books and 250 scientific articles. He is also the editor-in-chief of the most established journal in tourism, that is Tourism Review. His current research focus includes real-time and nowness, smart tourism and smart hospitality, social media context, and mobile marketing, augmented reality, technology-enhanced experience management and personalization, reputation and social media strategies, accessibility and special diet, that is allergens in tourism. Today, Professor Bouhalis will be throwing light on the topic, smart technologies and ambient intelligence to reignite tourism. Professor Bouhalis, a very warm welcome to you. And you can proceed with your topic. Thank you.
Namaste. A very good morning to you all. Can your administrators make me a co-host, please, so I can use all the facilities here? Thank you very much. Namaste, a very good morning to you. And it's great to be with you, even from a distance, and to support your conference and help India developing the tourism after the pandemic. It's also a great pleasure to see remotely my good friends Metin and Xavier that I haven't seen for a while, but we meet from conference to conference and we engage in different things. What I really want to talk to you about is smartness and how we can use technology to go forward and engage the tourism industry globally to develop the next years of tourism and make sure that communities take advantage of the developments that we're seeing ahead of us. And it's a great opportunity to actually share with you these things. Hopefully you should be able to see the slide now and you should see the beautiful Bournemouth beach that we've got on the background. A lot of the things I'm saying is based on the books that I've developed over the years, and I will welcome you to have a look, because obviously in 30 minutes there's very little we can actually deliver. And currently I'm editing the Tourism Review, the most established tourism journal. And also I'm finishing the Encyclopedia of Tourism Management and Marketing. I'm very grateful for your support because many of you have actually submitted terms for that. And today we're about, and you are the first conference to hear that, today we are uploading the Encyclopedia, and today it's kind of the soft launch day. And you can see the Encyclopedia on this URL. Now, what the encyclopedia is bringing together is bringing together all the knowledge that we've got in tourism. And we've got the tourism system on the top, where you've got the travel generation region, you've got the tourism destination region, you've got the transit region. And what we're trying to do is look into that as an ecosystem that works together in order to maximize the benefits for all the stakeholders that are involved in this. On the one side, we've got resources. On the other side, we've got value co-creation, which is the output, really, of what's happening. And over the years, we've realized that for tourism to operate well, it needs to have the planning and management, the strategy that addresses all the things that Xavier was talking about in terms of sustainability, environmental concerns, take care of the market forces, look at the exogenous variables, and there we're looking into a whole range of things that are influencing the tourism industry. And then it's using a layer of technology which provide the platform where everybody plugs and plays and operates together as a system. Now, a whole of these things are based on what I call smart and agile technologies, which are supporting us to develop a range of different things. So smartness is about the interconnectivity and interoperability of integrated technologies to re-engineer processes and data in order to produce innovation and in products, services, and processes. Re-engineering enables shaping products, actions, and services in real time by engaging different stakeholders. And the most important thing is it brings together the network, and we operate together as a network. And you'll see various publications and research projects I've done over the last few years, which are giving you a lot of information. So I don't have a lot of time to talk about all of those things, but you'll see the publications and you can see what's happening. So I said earlier, smartness is about networks, and it's really about the Internet of Things and the Internet of Everything. Get everything together to operate in a way that we maximize the value out of the big data that we've got, understand what the situation is in real time, and come back with value for everybody. We understand that smartness is disruptive, because it brings a range of different technologies that they synthesize innovations, and those innovations may put some of the existing players in the market in a challenging position. But also it brings fantastic opportunities where the supply chain, the consumer chain is coming in the middle. And then when they meet, they use all kinds of technologies, and they use location-based services and context-based services to actually specialize and create value that's individualized, contextualized, and personalized at that particular moment that's happening. And this is what we call SOCOMO, where you have social media and technology supporting context specific value that's communicated, and it's facilitated by mobile devices, whatever those mobile devices are. And context is really interesting, because we really need to understand the internal context, the people internally, what they feel internally, what's their interest, why they're there, what's their emotional status, what's their abilities and disabilities, and the external context, which tells us what's happening around us. And what's happening around us determines a lot of the things that people are doing. So back to what Xavier was doing, the context may be that may actually determine what people will do in different kind of situations. Because in different kind of situations, they'll understand the context in a different way, and they'll operate in a different way. Now, we've seen that there are good impacts of tourism and bad impacts of tourism. And we've seen the dark side of the sharing economy. This is some research we did in Barcelona, looking into how organizations and destinations can manage the resources and the sharing economy, so more people can actually take benefits of what you're doing in terms of tourism. And the other thing is that we were looking into social conduct. What kind of social conduct do people have when they are traveling? And you see, people have got social contact in face-to-face kind of interactions, but also they've got a whole range of online interactions that are happening. And this social contact determines what actually they do, how they operate, where they go, what they do, how much money they spend. And it's really critical that we understand how technology can empower that kind of social interactions in different contexts and facilitate those different reactions. When you look at what people do, you find that there are different kind of typologies and there are different kind of consumers when they're traveling. On the one side, you've got what we call the home zone, that they're taking their home with them. So they are constantly connected. They operate in online environment and they control their life. They're working with social media, they're streaming, they're doing all kinds of things. On the other side, you've got consumers that they are digitally detoxing. They go somewhere, they lock their mobile phone on the hotel safe, and they're totally disconnected. And you see on this paper the different typologies that we've identified of people who are using technology differently when they drive. What is really critical is how big data empowers agility for a very dynamic, volatile, and time-sensitive service industry like tourism. And what kind of data do we need in order to maximize the value that's being created out of that? And of course, data is driving us to nowness and real-time service, where we look into what is happening currently in our proximity and what can we do about it? Because if you're traveling in a place in different contexts, you'll probably end up doing different things. If it's raining, you may go to a museum. If it's sunny, you may go to a park or you may go to the seaside. And a lot of those things are driven by data, which then create customer centricity. And then they enhance experience in real time by co-creating value for everybody who is involved. So you've got the real time triggers here that they are starting a contextual relevance kind of value co-creation. And you've got this circle here that's maximizing the value in this particular moment, which we call nowness. And this creates more value for all the stakeholders that are involved. We're getting to a situation which we call ambient intelligence, where everything's connected with everything. And you've got systems, vehicles, and everything connected with artificial intelligence and machine learning. And these kind of systems will enable everybody to plug and play and get value out of these systems. And really about interconnected environments which are managing interaction between all players in the marketplace. So I call it human-to-human interaction, where you've got business, governments, consumers, employees, interest groups, local residents, robots, and machines, all of those things interacting simultaneously and in real time. The minute we're going towards a high level of technology and artificial intelligence, those interactions are happening in nanoseconds. So we are gonna go to a new kind of situation where a lot of the negotiations, a lot of the interactions, a lot of the engagement is going to be in nanoseconds, and this is what we call the real time. So you've got the customers in the middle, or the stakeholders, in fact, can be residents, can be anybody who is in the middle, and they're using a whole range of technologies to actually engage with the environment and engage with everybody else in the environment and maximize the benefits that they get out. Now, smartness is disruptive. It is changing dramatically the way we operate, and it is changing a lot of the things that we do in terms of impacts and in terms of engagement that we've got with our environment. And everything was happening in 2019 was a fantastic year as far as tourism is concerned. We're growing and we had a lot of benefits, and we were talking about how we can manage the situation in a better way, in a more sustainable way, and then COVID happened. And in the last year or so, we had a significant amount of deaths around the world. We had a lot of people who died, and we had a tragic environment, and the context became tragic globally. And in different countries, you can see how many people have died. In India, you almost can count 60,000 people who have died in the last year. And it's still not over. And you can see that we went from a peak down to somehow in the middle of the summer in Europe, it was kind of a little bit manageable. And then after Christmas, it became really, really unmanageable again. This creates a whole range of problems, not only health problems, but also economic problems. It's a tsunami of economic problems that they are facing us. And this is how many jobs are at risk around the world. The only way to describe it is a war. It's really a war. And when you've got war, you've got a lot of damage. Not only a lot of people die, but you've got a lot of buildings, a lot of infrastructure that's being destroyed. And these are the heroes. The heroes are those people who have been battling on the forefront of the health battlefields where they are trying to save lives every day. And sadly, a lot of these lives have not been, we couldn't save these lives. Now, I came early from COVID, and I focused on four things that I think that we need to have in order to get to the next stage, which is humanity, solidarity, leadership, and resilience. Resilience is really critical to bring all of those things together, but I think humanity and solidarity as a global society is absolutely critical, and we need leaders to take us to that way. And we know that we cannot travel today, or it's kind of getting a little bit better, but still, this is Bournemouth Airport, where a lot of the planes from British Airways have been parked, waiting for the restart that they're going to take us forward. And a lot of the business we have been doing for the last year, it's business as usual, and our heroes have been supporting not only society by transferring people and transferring materials, but also all the medical supplies and all the medical people. These are my heroes, and they've been every day on the front line helping people around the world. Now, as far as tourism is concerned, we dropped 74% of international tourism. Some places, some big places gained in terms of domestic tourism, but the industry is really, really battered. And we talked about the jobs at risk already. Now, the positive things that we can see light at the end of the tunnel, and although we'll have to keep the protocols to stay safe, the vaccination is giving us a whole range of new era of optimism to move forward. I've done mine a couple of weeks ago, and I'm looking forward to get my second vaccine so I can move forward. Having said that, the current vaccination level is about 5% around the world. There are some countries, and you'll see in the next slide, they've been doing much more, but a lot of countries have not even started yet. And I think we really need to show solidarity until everybody is vaccinated, until we've got global immunity. We're not going to be out of the threat for COVID. And you can see here the percentage of people who have been vaccinated in different countries. So Israel is winning the race with 110% vaccination level. And United Arab Emirates and the UK is getting almost to 40%. Yesterday, the minister announced 25 million people have been vaccinated. But if you are going down the list, and I don't have, yeah, I've got India here, it's 2.4%. The world is about 4.9%. So we really need to move as fast as possible with the vaccines. And the big conversation that's happening is whether we need certificates to travel and whether we need a vaccine passport or whatever. We always had from the World Health Organization this little passport, that's the certificate of international, the international certificate of vaccinations that brings all your vaccinations. In some countries, you cannot go without it. So that my three passports, and I've already registered my vaccination. And I think that will be essential in the future. We can see the rainbow after the storm. And of course, it's a really difficult storm. And I said it's kind of a war, but that's we can see how we're going to get out of this. The positive thing is that we have not lost our assets. The negative thing is that we've lost a lot of life and in this process. But the assets are still there. The beauty of different places, this is Santorini in Greece, and I know you've got a lot of beautiful places all over the world. They're still there inviting us to create experiences and look into the local resources and engaging in authentic experience with us. I think what's very critical is to understand that we are not going to go backwards. So a lot of people are saying, let's go back to 2019. I don't think it's going to be relevant. I think we're going to look forward to a new situation where we need to look forward to the context and understanding what we'll be able to do in the future. And I think the future is holding a particular place where we are going to be in a situation that we will need to begin, that will have the end of planning and the time to actually think about things for a long time and plan them properly, and the beginning of the agility. And this is where the real-time thing is becoming really, really important. I think herd immunity and smart and agile tourism is going to be absolutely critical on the things that we do. And resilience is also very critical on how we're going to go forward. Several countries and several companies are preparing for that. Singapore and Singapore Airlines has vaccinated all their crew, and they're preparing for that. Qantas has announced with Alan Joyce saying that they will only transfer people who have been vaccinated in their flights, and increasingly cruise companies are coming forward and they're saying a lot of these things. Now, technology is bringing us a lot of those benefits and a lot of those tools to navigate out of the situation and go forward to to a much more interesting and versatile kind of situation. So we see a lot of smart systems and a lot of applications that help us navigate in different places. We see track and trace applications where we'll kind of see where people have been and who have they been with and whether they had any epidemiological load and whether whether they are ill themselves and what else is happening. Yesterday, the European Commission brought the Digital Green Certificate forward and announced that in order that the European countries will kind of adopt that, that it's going to facilitate travel. So travelers will have to be either vaccinated or have a negative test or have recovered for COVID, so they've developed immunity. It's really critical that we have that we create immunity in order to be able to protect ourselves and also protect everybody in the ecosystem. And a lot of other countries have done that already from quite early. So this is China. And Thailand recently created the application that everybody needs to have before they arrive in Thailand. And they track and trace, and at the same time, they kind of communicate with travelers during their time. And you can see a lot of this information on this video, which I don't have the time to play. I think it's critical that governments prioritize aviation and tourism professionals to get access to vaccines because they're exposed to health threats and also they can become part of the problem. So we really need to get forward with a lot of these things. IATA has been playing a great role on helping redevelop and restart tourism, especially with the travel pass application. And a lot of companies, airlines around the world, they're using it. Increasingly, it's more and more companies I see every day that there are more organizations who are joining it. And actually, yesterday, the first passenger that arrived in London from Singapore on Singapore Airlines 308 was the first passenger that they use the IATA travel pass to arrive in London without having to do quarantine. So what the travel pass is doing is creating a secure digital version of the passport on their mobile device. They input flight details to find requirements, and they receive a verified test results and a confirmation that they're okay to travel. And all that will be operated together in one way. So it will all be integrated and bring all the stakeholders together. Some hotels around the world have been doing great things. So this hotel Icon Hong Kong, where I collaborate, and they've had a range of different protocols that they are using in order to make sure that everybody is safe and they can operate safely. In different airports, in different places, you see a lot of those kind of equipment. And I think one of the other things is that we really need to look into spaces and understand how we can ventilate the spaces in a better way, how we can redesign flows, and how we can engage with the different kind of stakeholders in a way that we can still maximize the value that we co-create. Again, technology is very critical, because with the mobile, and you remember on the Socomo, we said that mobile is very critical in terms of how we operate at the destination, but the mobile now is becoming the remote control of a whole different kind of things, from controlling television, from hotel guides, from ordering room service, and engaging with everybody else without touching most of the environment that we are sharing with other people. I think this is an immediate kind of thing to get out of COVID, but at the same time, that creates an infrastructure that will see us going forward with different things. Also, technology will help us to disinfect our environment and taking care of some of the things that are happening. And I think one of the big things that we are seeing coming forward is robots and robotic technology. Someone is doing something on the screen that doesn't need to be there. And I think robots will kind of help us develop some of these things. This is in the HANA hotels. Robots, it's a very big discussion that we can have soon, but robots will see a range of different processes being re-engineered in tourism, and we need to start thinking about the disruptive nature of robots and how we're going to operate different things. And you can see things on how we'll be able to use some of these robotic arms for cooking, or some of these crazy things for serving. Now, currently, what you see is that robots are seen as an innovation, and a lot of people are going to places like that just to see a little bit of fun and play with the robots and see how the robots can actually do, and they become part of the attraction. But eventually, they'll be part of the service, and they'll be part of the engagement. Let me remove one person, which I think is creating problems. Okay. And then quite often we're talking about these things and we're thinking about the future, but actually the future is here. So we'll see robots actually doing things that humans don't want to do. I don't know anybody who would like to do room service at 4 o'clock in the morning and waiting for someone to call and say, can you bring me a Coke in my room, please, because I cannot sleep. So I think increasingly we'll see a lot of robotics coming forward. And I think the other thing that is coming, which is a very big thing as far as technology is concerned, is autonomous vehicles and machines that they use artificial intelligence to operate themselves, so self-driving. So when the cars can actually drive themselves and all the other devices can actually drive themselves, will be in a very different situation that we haven't been in the past. And a lot of those things will come into my other book on gamification that's about to come out in a month's time, that is looking to how we can take advantage of all those technologies and create better experience for people when they are traveling. And I'll leave you with this slide, because when I talk about these things, people think that this is something that's going to happen in the future. But in fact, it's things that are happening currently. So this is the New Century Grand Hotel in Hangzhou, in China, where I was there last year. And this little fellow was trying to get into the elevator, and he was following me around. So he became my best friend. He could speak better English than a lot of the local staff on the hotel, and was very helpful in doing different things. What I'm trying to say is that we need to look into what change is coming forward with all these technologies and all these new tools that are happening. And I think technology will be disruptive, but also will bring value. And I think those of you who are studying these areas, who are researching these areas, you need to look into how we can take advantage of those things for our society. Now, this is a long list of publications from the last few years, but all of those things are part of the conversation that we had today. Please have a look online and download those publications and have a look. Thank you very much. Namaste.
Thank you, Professor Buhalius, for your enlightening words, and will be very useful, I think, in the coming future. Indeed, we have realized the importance of ICT technologies in this COVID times, and I hope for a better future of tourism, and hope that it will be reignited in the coming times. Thank you once again, Professor.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.